and welcome back to the Good News. I'm Tisa.
And I'm Doc.
And we are excited and delighted to be here with you another week full of good news.
I love some good news.
Okay.
So give me some good news.
Mask or no mask? That is the question.
You know, maybe we should have worn some masks just to show them what they look like for those who don't understand what a mask is. Now, anytime,
yeah.
Now you know, I'm going to tell you, I ain't going to call a person's name, but somebody said, I don't know what's the big deal about masks. Some of y'all been wearing masks all your life. We don't know who you are.
I just don't see where the challenge is and why people, we saw the video where the women were going to the grocery store and they waited on the clerk to tell them to put on masks and then they took off their panties and put it over their face.
I remember that.
I was like, what in the world? So I don't have a dog in the fight because I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to put on my mask. And so I don't know why people are so resistant.
I think it was like, I'm not sure if you shared the post with me or I saw it somewhere else, but the post said that, you know, I'm confused. I don't know if I should trust doctors and internists and all those people who studied all this stuff, or should I trust someone who flunked 10th grade science?
Yeah.
You know, I'm confused. I don't know who should I trust. Should I trust those experts from the CDC and Johns Hopkins, or should I trust some of y'all who didn't know how to... Say, then no science, 10th grade science.
Yeah.
I'm confused, y'all help me.
So, I'm gonna lean with the epidemiologist.
Epidemiologist, thank you for saying that word. Big word.
Big word, yep.
Epidemiologist.
Well, other than the mask or no mask, the thing that came to me today, this because we are learning so much more about coronavirus. You know, your president says it's got too many names. That's why we can't win. It's COVID-19. It's coronavirus. It's SARS.
Well, he could have been a doctor because his uncle was a doctor. Why he didn't know?
I mean, it's all these different names. So, but COVID-19, one of the things that we were hopeful for initially is that, when it get hot, the summer will kill it. Well, it's 120 degrees in Texas and right behind that in Florida, and that has not proven to be the case.
So the summer don't kill it. What's going to happen when fall and winter come?
So it's just so amazing how we have these specialists, epidemiologists, and all of these people that are working on this virus, and we're learning so much, but we just haven't been able to get ahead of it to put some responses in place that are able to slow the spread, flatten the curve, do all those things we're trying to do. It's just so interesting how much knowledge we have and have gained, and we're still losing. We lost C.T. Vivian and Congressman John Lewis this week.
The Right Reverend C.T. Vivian was a pillar in the community. Yeah. He was one that a lot of people went to for wisdom and advice, and just had this strong sense of this
presence. Yeah, that's it. It really is. Yeah. And people don't recognize that as ministry. Mm-hmm. Just you be in some place that will just straighten up some of the things that might have happened. Just because you were there, things were different.
I thank God for his life.
Yes.
I thank God for the impact he had on ministry here in the metro Atlanta area and nationwide.
Mm-hmm.
And the same with Congressman John Lewis.
Mm-hmm.
Congressman John Lewis, he fought all the way for the rights of people who were disenfranchised, all the way up to his last breath.
Mm-hmm. And that is our hope for everyone who is living, that you have an impact on somebody else, that you make this world a better place by your having been here. And both of those men can assuredly say, and rest well with jobs well done.
I put, it's part of my book, Marching Towards Your Purpose, where I had a quote. I said, you don't deserve to die until you live out your purpose. I truly believe they both live their purpose and job well done.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
And so that's a great segue into our breakdown of the message we had today.
Yeah.
I didn't preach.
I didn't preach either.
You didn't preach. We had a guest preacher and we were surely blessed. Michael Ware delivered a word from on high to Champions for Christ today, and we were surely blessed by the preparation that he put into the message and the delivery. You know, you as preachers, we know the preparation that goes behind delivering a word of that power, and that you have to be walking toe-to-toe with the Lord as you get ready to stand before God's people. So the title of the message was, Where is Jesus in Your Boat? And you know, I the first thing I thought about was how you always talk about the bumper sticker that says, Jesus is my co-pilot.
Yeah.
I said, well, you're an idiot because you need to let Jesus drive.
I know, right?
And so he asked the question, where is Jesus in your boat? And he came from that familiar passage of scripture from Luke, the 8th chapter, where the disciples find themselves on the lake. You know, a lake that they were familiar with, doing what they're familiar doing, and a storm fell upon them. And they were shocked to paralysis. They were scared. They were...
It amazes me. And he said something that was so important. Even us as disciples allow fear into situations where faith should be.
Come on.
And it was funny because he said, notice what they didn't do. They didn't cast lots.
Nope.
You know, like they, you know, the disciples love to cast lots and stuff.
Yes, they do.
But they didn't cast lots. Uh-huh. They said, we all need to go and wake up Jesus.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
My thing is, if Jesus is asleep, I need to go to sleep. Mm-hmm. I ain't, you know, because I don't know what's going to happen when Jesus ain't up. So if Jesus sleep, it's like in the house when I was little growing up, when the grown people went to sleep, I went to sleep because the boogeyman might have came out at nighttime and I ain't going to be up by myself. So I'm going to sleep too. I would have went to sleep if Jesus was asleep.
You know, the what was so interesting was the text, and you know, we've read it before and we've heard it before, but I'm just looking at some of the words that Dr. Luke uses. He said that they're in jeopardy. We're perishing. I mean, we can use some real words when we are worried and scared, and foreclosure and repossession, all those big words start showing up.
You know what? You just said something then, because you addressed him as Dr. Luke and all those words he said. I grew up watching a show called Lost in Space.
Mm-hmm.
And there was this character on that name, Dr. Zachary Smith.
Uh-huh.
And he was always a doomsayer, you know. he always did stuff, and he was just so fearful, and he was a doctor.
Was that the Will Robinson?
That's it.
I remember that.
And Dr. Smith was the one that just used all those big words to describe doom.
Yep.
And Dr. Luke doing the same thing. So Dr. Smith must have been a disciple.
Yeah. And so, of course, this passage is talking about how we, even though they were with Jesus, how we can be Bible-toting, professing Christians, and can tell you some things, speaking to somebody else's life. Mm-hmm. But when something comes to us, then we operate out of fear first.
Yeah.
Even if we do like the disciples and go to Jesus later, we operate out of fear first, and how to just turn that around in our lives.
And you know, one thing I think it really said, a point that was made too that made me feel good throughout the message, was when he talked about how he believed what the Bible says about, and he gave examples of, we wouldn't know who Daniel was if he wouldn't have went into the lion's den, and we wouldn't have knew about the three Hebrew boys if they wouldn't have went into the fire furnace and put God to the test by trusting the process.
Yep.
And I love how he said, trusting the process.
And he went on to say that trust is the process.
Trust is the process.
Trust is the process that gets us to faith, that gets us to believe, that gets us to, okay, why are we up here perishing when we got Jesus? What we have to do is go where our help comes from.
And you know, it's I love how this stuff unfolds. It made me think about one of your favorite NBA players that you made his name speaks loud to me. Joel Embiid.
The process.
I love it.
So it is important for us as Christians, no matter what the storm looks like, to remember that our God is bigger than any storm. He went on to read some more from Romans.
He had a shout when he started reading to Romans, especially when he went to the 31st and 35th verse.
Yes, if God is for us, who can be against
us? You can't read that text and don't expect somebody to tell the church up with a shout.
You know? What do you think the boat was going to do with Jesus in it?
You know,
the boat would have saved itself.
Yeah, the water was, oh, Jesus in here, you know. And I love how a lot of times you read in the Bible, this was for the benefit of those.
Yeah,
you know, that was for the benefit of the disciples. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Don't you know who's in your boat?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it was like the opposite of another person who had the name of Jay in a boat, and the storm came. You know, they had to throw him overboard. your favorite prophet.
Jonah. He's a good prophet. And so one of the and Pastor Warren went on to use some big words too.
Yeah, he did.
He gave us the concept of homeostasis. And that just means that we're always trying our bodies. You can work out and lose 50 pounds, but your body has a set point that it wants to be at. And it's going to try to do everything it can to get back to that set point of where it feels safe.
Yeah. You know, trying to get back to that place that you're supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought about Dorothy from The Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
I wish I were home. You know, so that homeostasis, it just spoke volume to how
really?
We interpret mm-hmm. what it is for us to be children of God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And fear and faith can't operate in the same place. And so, you know, it goes back to what you said last time was that after you've done all you know to do.
Yeah,
so don't stay there. Mm-hmm. Go directly to the source of our help. I can't imagine having Jesus right there and being in fear. And he closed us out with some good words from his great-granddad and his granddad and just some great men of God that have poured into his life. And amen. What
third generation pastor.
Yes.
Goodness gracious.
So he talked about that our what happens depends on our view.
Mm-hmm.
And so he used the analogy of, again, a repossession.
Yeah.
Now you can look at that as a failure and a loss, and but he said you can also look at it as, oh God, getting ready to get me a new car because I need one, so I no more have to have one.
Yeah.
And so it really depends on the view that we take. Mm-hmm. And when you are on the Lord's side, and when you know that the Lord is on your side, and that all things work together for good because you love him, then you don't ever have a view that is not that silver lining in the cloud, because our God is able. And that's really all that we need to know, that he is able.
Paul could have used many words to go before that word things, but he chose to the A.
Come on.
All things.
There is not one thing that is too
not
hard
some,
for
not
our
Not a
God.
Few, not many, but all things. And all encompasses everything.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I guess it's the makeup of the Fellowship of Champions for Christ,
mm-hmm.
where we bring that energy to our worship experience, and uh-huh. we come on ready for, you know, you don't have to lead us up the big hill or the roller coaster to get us ready for word.
Mm-hmm.
We come ready, and he came out the gates ready.
Yes, it was such a blessing. So thank you, Pastor Ware, for blessing us with the word this morning. You have definitely encouraged us so that we can make it through this week that we have not seen before, and we don't know what's prepared in it, but we are ready.
You know, I hope and pray that other churches could have something similar to what we have in having some of this great work. I've been privileged and honored to have two of God's greatest preachers preaching at Champions for Christ and joining me in this ministry throughout this pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And it has made this whole pandemic more bearable,
mm-hmm.
more understandable, and more to the point that we know that this is not the end.
That's it.
And I just thank God for the team that God has put around me, those who support Champions for Christ, and those who enjoy good news.
That's it. And we want to thank each and every one of you for tuning in each and every week to celebrate the goodness of God here with us. There is always good news in the Lord.
Yeah, I hope depending on your view.
That's it. I hope that you will follow me at Tisa J is for Joy, and take a listen to my podcast. It's Choose Joy with Tisa, and it's a daily prayer podcast to get you some high octane fuel so that you can go into your day.
And I want you to join me on YouTube at Be Better on Purpose with Dr. Darryl L. Jones. And also this weekend, and this weekend only, you can get Marching Toward Your Purpose absolutely free.
Oh, that's my favorite cost.
Marching Toward Your Purpose is free. Just go to www.bebetteronpurpose.com and tell them I sent you. But free book. Free book, www.bebetteronpurpose.com. And tell me what you think about it. And I want to see you hit 8 to 5 marching towards your purpose. And you have to be in the band and know what that 8 to 5 means. If not, ask somebody from the HBCU band. They'll tell you what the 8 to 5 means.
Thank you so much. And thank you for encouraging the people with your videos. They have been awesome.
Thank you.
And thank you for sharing Marching Towards Your Purpose with us for free.
Do you know how much value that book is going to bring to your life?
I know. It is surely a blessing. So thank you.
Amen.
And thank each and every one of you for joining us here again at Fit News. We will see you next time.